Good morning, Journey. It's time for some quick announcements. The Journey Student Ministries Fall Retreat for 7th through 12th graders is coming up November 17th through 18th, the weekend before Thanksgiving. It'll be a chance for them to rest and reset before the holidays get all crazy. The cost is only $95 per student, and you can get more information, sign up, and pay on the Church Center app or on our website, journeycs.org. The deadline to sign up is tonight at midnight. Are you new to Journey and want to know more about what we're all about? Mapping the Journey is our information class for anyone interested in learning about our church and taking the next steps in getting plugged in. This class is scheduled every few months during both Sunday services at 9 and 10:45 a.m. Our next one is coming up next Sunday, November 19th. You can register in the Church Center app or just show up and attend. Either way, we want you to feel welcome and we are excited to meet you. Those interested will just gather in the back of the auditorium after morning announcements and then head on to Pastor Landon's office. It's an opportunity you won't want to miss. If you're a guest with us today, we are so happy you're here. If you haven't already, we'd love it if you could fill out a connection card in the seat in front of you and drop it in the drop box at the back of the sanctuary so we can have a record of your visit and welcome you here. Now, let's rejoice in this day the Lord has made and let's praise Him together in worship.
As we wait upon the Lord, we will wait. Power in the You may be seated. John 8:36 says, "So if the Son has set you free, you are free indeed." You're free. As we step into our freedom series, I want to encourage you maybe to go to the scriptures and look up as many scriptures as you can that have to do with freedom. And you're going to find that they always point back to this place right here. They always point back to our communion, which symbolizes the death of Christ for our sins. He became our substitute for our sins so that we don't have to pay the consequences of our choices. He made it possible for us to have a relationship with God, an unbroken relationship with Him that is mended and healed. This morning, we have stations in the front and four in the front and four in the back, and make your way to the closest one during this next song. If you're new to our community, I just want to let you know that you're welcome to communion. It's His table and He invites you. We are grateful to be able to provide it for you today. The bread symbolizes His body that was broken for you, and the juice His blood that was shed for you so that you could be in a right relationship with Him. Please bow your heads and let's pray. Holy God, thank you again. And during this next song, I just pray that our minds will be focused on you and what you've done for us. The fact that you did it and we don't have to, that we just have to believe and step into it and allow you to cover us with your presence. Your Holy Spirit comes inside of us when we give our lives to you and you take up residence and you find your home in us, and we become an outward expression and an inward expression of who Jesus is. I pray that the people in the greater China Spring area, Bosqueville, all over this area, greater Waco, I pray that people will come in contact with you through us. But now, Lord, in this moment, we remember that you've done it for us. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken, 'cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I I
my words fall short. I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do. Every song is
Father, it is so, so good to worship you and to raise up your name and just declare your wonder. Thank you for meeting us here. Thank you for teaching us once again of how good you are. Father, let us live truly in the freedom that you bring. It's in Jesus we pray. Amen. Y'all can have a seat. It is so good to worship our God together, isn't it? We talk about the tithe every week and give you an opportunity there. And one of the things that we point you to is that the tithe is truly an extension of our worship. It's not just a sacrifice or a gift, but it is truly a sacrifice of praise. There's a really beautiful picture of that in the Hebrew Scriptures. It comes from Deuteronomy chapter 14. So in that, Deuteronomy is this stage where people of Israel have been delivered. They've wandered through the wilderness for 40 years because of their rebellion, but they have come to the end of that. And they're at the edge of the promised land. And Moses is taking some time to give some instructions to the people, to remind them of who they are, to set up the environment that they're going to create once they enter the land. And in Deuteronomy chapter 14, he comes back to the tithe. It's something that had already been established. It's something that had been put in their law. But he reminds them what this is and what they're about. And he describes this moment of worship out of the tithe. So I'm going to read for a second. What I want you to hear this morning is an instruction with three explanations. He has three so that's, because God's wanting to accomplish something through our tithe. Listen to what he says. He says in Deuteronomy 14, starting verse 22, he says, "Be sure to set aside a tenth of all of your fields that your fields produce each year." That's the instruction. Set aside a tenth, and that's actually where they get the word tithe from. That's what it means. It means a tenth. And he goes on and explains what to set aside. "Eat the tithe of your grain, new wine, and olive oil, and of the firstborn of your herds and flocks, in the presence of the Lord your God, at the place he will choose as a dwelling for his name." So you got to listen to it, but here's the environment of what's happening with the tithe. He's like, set aside all of your stuff, well, all of your stuff that is related to your food. Set aside your grain, your wheat, all of your crops, like a tenth of that, put it away. And all your livestock, all your animals, put it away. And then bring them to me. And let's have a party. He's like, we're gonna eat this meal of what you've set aside in the presence of the Lord at the place that he's gonna establish, but ultimately became his temple. It's this grand worship service that is surrounded in a feast where both God and his people are eating. God, through burnt sacrifices. Like they actually took the food that was set aside, put it on the altar, and burn it up. And that was God's part. And they got to eat in the midst of their worship. Here's your first so that. He says, so that you may revere the Lord your God always. So that God will be God for you. Like, pull out a tenth of your stuff, set it aside, and worship me with it so that I can be your God. And that stuff isn't. Now, this text goes on, and Moses gives some more instruction. I'm not going to read all that. You can go read it. Deuteronomy 14, verse 24 through 26. He's basically saying, when you're traveling to the temple to do this, like, if you're having to travel too far, then it's okay. Like, you can exchange your cattle and the crops for silver and then buy it back when you get to the temple. You don't have to have this huge cattle drive, right? But let's do this. And then something interesting happens. He turns at the end of this discussion to give two more so that's. In verse 27, he says, and do not neglect the Levites living in your towns, for they have no allotment or inheritance of their own. Basically saying, don't neglect the priests and the tribe of the priests, because they don't have land. They don't have secular jobs. They're dedicated to the temple and the worship of God and to serving the people. They're dependent on you. So let's take care of them. But not just them. He goes on. At the end of every 3 years, bring all the tithes of the year's produce and store it in your towns, so that the Levites who have no allotment or inheritance of their own, the foreigners, the fatherless, and the widows who live in your towns may come and eat and be satisfied, and so that the Lord may bless you in all the work of your hands. He's like, we're not just going to come and sacrifice our stuff to worship our God, but every third year, you're going to take that same tithe and you're going to store it in your storehouses in your own towns. Why? So that the priests and the widows and the fatherless and the foreigners, those who don't have, can be taken care of, so that in the place of God and his people, may it never be said that there are people wanting and not being cared for. Journey, we tithe out of this history. We tithe out of the people of God learning to revere God over our stuff. We tithe so that those who don't have may be taken care of by the people of God. And the last so that, we tithe, he says, so that I may bless you. So, Father, we ask that you do these things. We ask that we become a people of sacrifice and watch you work. Bless our tithe. Bless the work of our hands that we do in your name. It's in Jesus we pray. Amen. as we move through those things, you can tithe several ways. You can scan that code and do it now or later. You can tithe online through our Church Center app. There's also a physical drop box in the back. Let's be a people of sacrifice and blessing.
We are, this is the second week that we're in a new series that we're calling Reimagining Freedom. And Landon kicked us off last week by starting chapter 5 of Galatians, and I'm going to close us in chapter 5 of Galatians as we keep going. But before we get started, I want to share a quote from the year before I was born in the late 1900s. Okay, I was hoping that joke would land because I needed an early win, okay? Yeah, so this is the year 1992. Supreme Court Justice Anthony Kennedy wrote in Planned Parenthood versus Casey, "At the heart of liberty is the right to define one's own concept of existence, of meaning, of the universe, and of the mystery of human life." This was the year before I was born. So you could say this was the environment, this was the culture, this was the belief system in which I was born and raised and lived. And this is something that our kids nowadays are growing up in, that there is a completely different idea of what freedom is. It's a freedom to do whatever you want, however you want, whenever you want, with no objections. And we talked about last week how this is a very different view of what Scripture has of freedom. In John chapter 8, Jesus gives the most extensive teaching he ever gives on the devil. And this is one of the verses that he teaches on in John 8:44. "You belong to your father, the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding on to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father. He is the father of lies." That is his title. Whatever you want to call him, Satan, devil, the enemy, the accuser, what is he at his most core? The father of lies. And the imagery and the metaphor of a father, let's lean into that. A father reproduces himself, gives birth, and gives birth to what lies. That is his inheritance, and that is what he passes on, is lies. And lying is his native language. That is the very words and system that he knows. He is a liar. And here's why I share this. I'm convinced that lies are the primary weapon the devil uses against us. John Mark Comer, in his book, Live No Lies, he gives a helpful framework to think about this, and this is what he says. Deceptive ideas that play to disordered desires that are then normalized into a sinful society. And this morning, as we finish Galatians 5, we're going to focus on the flesh, our disordered desires, and the consequences that we have when we play into those. Okay, so before we get too far, let's back up. And before we get to Galatians, we should start with the person we should always start with. Let's start with Jesus. In Matthew 16, Jesus gives the most fundamental, the most basic, the most essential two verses that you and I need to know. If the devil's biggest play is lies and disordered desires to us, what is Jesus wanting for us? Matthew 16, starting verse 24. "Then Jesus said to his disciples, 'Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will find it.'" So if you want to be a disciple of Jesus, if you want to follow him and live with him, you must. This is a key word, must. This is not an option. It's not a negotiation. It's not an add-on bonus. You must deny yourself and pick up your cross and follow him. Denying yourself and an instrument of self-denial and sacrifice to follow Jesus. Dietrich Bonhoeffer says, when Christ calls a man, he bids him come and die. But we have a hard time embracing this kind of faith in Jesus, that we must deny ourselves, pick up a cross. This is a hard thing to accept because we wish that there was a different way. And we are not the only people to wish that there was a different way than to deny ourselves. I want to introduce you to our good friend Peter. He himself, like us, wished that there was a different way, that you could avoid serving others, avoid sacrifice, avoid denying yourself. Three verses before Jesus gives that teaching, this is what we read in Matthew 16. From that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and on the third day be raised to life. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Never, Lord, he said, this will never happen to you. Jesus turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. Of things that Jesus could call you, Satan is probably in the top five. Actually, let's say it's definitely in the top five, all right? And Jesus says, Satan, what an insult, what a letdown. I'm sure he's pretty bummed. Why this harsh rebuke from Jesus? Because Peter was trying to get in the way of the cross. Peter was against self-denial. Peter was against the hard and difficult way by which love, peace, and grace would enter in the world. He wished there was a different option. And Jesus, his method was self-sacrifice, to serve others, to deny himself. And in the Western church, we have lost sight of Jesus' invitation to deny ourselves and to take our cross and follow him. We have lost sight that we follow and believe in a suffering Messiah. We have forgotten that the methods that brought about peace was sacrifice and service. Instead, we have exchanged the truth of God for a lie. And that lie is that our desires, what we want, is most important. And what is the devil? He is the father of lies. And I'm convinced this is his biggest and primary lie that he is using in the Western church, especially in America right now. That you, with your desires, should satisfy them. No restraint. What you want, fulfill. You have desire, seek to satisfy it. And Jesus will forgive you. In Jesus' name, the American way. So let's get to Galatians 5, not to bum you out. We're finally in Galatians. Open up to Galatians 5, and we're going to be starting verse 13. So this is our teaching text for the day. We're going to be in Galatians 5, starting in verse 13. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. So he talks about freedom, but he inserts another word into the mix of the equation with freedom, and that word is love. How in the world do freedom and love go together? How are they compatible? When we abuse freedom, we always negate love. When we abuse freedom, we always negate love. For Paul, the opposite of indulging your flesh and getting whatever your heart desires and having no constraints or self-control is to love and serve others. And love, at its most fundamental, love in biblical terms, in its most purest form, always seeks to give, not to take. It's to want the best for the other, no matter the cost. It's to do whatever possible to bring about who God has created in the person in front of you to become the person that he has created them to be. Quite simply, to indulge the flesh is to be out of love. To serve and love others is to be in love. And so here's what this means. In the kingdom of God, we are free even if we don't get what we want. And this is some incredible news. We are free even when we don't get what we want. We are free when we are content when we go to our spouse's choice for dinner and not our own. We are free when we find joy in pausing our TV show to give attention and care to our kids, even though we had a long day and this is me time. We are free when we have peace, even after a difficult conversation with a best friend. We are free when we can leave our phones at home when we go for a walk or a hike. We are free when we are satisfied with what we have instead of going into debt to get things with never-ending monthly bills. Paul is begging and pleading the Galatian church, do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh, but rather to serve others. And so here's the thing about freedom. And many people in this room understand this. We literally just got done celebrating this yesterday, this weekend, for Veterans Day. Freedom always is the result of winning a war. Freedom is always the result of winning a war. And so the rest of our time, I'm going to use three metaphors that Paul uses to frame the text. And that is a battle, fruit, and walk. And so the first one, battle. Here's what he says in verse 16. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of your flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. We are in a battle. Paul, elsewhere in Ephesians 6, says this, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the spiritual forces of evil. In 2 Corinthians 10, he says, the weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. And these weapons have divine power to demolish strongholds. Over 2,000 years ago in the art of war, we get the iconic line, know your enemy. Who is our enemy? Our enemy is not other people. Our enemy isn't the Democrats or the Republicans. Our enemy isn't your disobedient child or your lazy spouse. Hard to believe, I know. Your enemy isn't your boss that is quick to give more responsibilities and slow to give a pay raise for said work. Our enemy isn't the rise of technology and social media. Our enemy is not your neighbor. Who is our enemy? The desires of our flesh, what Paul says. The battle that we're in is against the desires of the flesh and the desire of the Spirit. And so often, it is so easy to drift into desires that the flesh wants to satisfy, any and every desire. But that word flesh is weird. I don't know if you use that word often, nice flesh, like you don't really say that. So in the scriptures, what does flesh mean? Flesh can mean body, like this is my flesh. Yes, that's used in the scriptures. There's three different ways you can use flesh. That is one of them. That is not the way that Paul is using flesh in this part of Galatians. Flesh, in this context, is the sinful appetite in all of us that feels natural to our bodies and yet is wrong. I can't preach without using a Eugene Peterson quote. He's my favorite. This is how he describes the flesh. The corruption that sin has introduced into our very appetites and instincts. So notice, it's not just desires are bad. Desires are good. It's just these desires have been corrupted by sin, have been hijacked and taken over, and has been introduced into our already God-given appetites and instincts to be distorted into something it was never meant to be. And there's been a lot of shifting when it comes to our desires and to the flesh in church history. Augustine, one of the greatest church fathers in the early church, he basically said that the human problem that we wrestle with is that we have disordered desires or loves. It's not that we don't love, it's that we either love the wrong things or love the right things in the wrong order. So for Augustine, it's not wrong for you to love your job, that's okay. It is wrong for you to love your job more than your teenage son. It's okay to love sex, but if you love it to the point where it becomes an idol or a god where you demand from another person and treat it as merely a physical act that you use people for, that's something quite different. So yes, we are innate lovers and we have desires that God has given us, but the problem is they are disordered and not in the correct hierarchy. And speaking of sex, Freud comes along and changes that up from Augustine in our church history. Freud comes along in the late 1800s and early 1900s, and he says something completely different. Okay, I know Augustine said that you are lovers and you have disordered desires. That is wrong. Essentially, Freud comes along and says, really, the most important desire that humans have is pleasure. So yes, sexual, but really pleasure in the big picture. And if you repress any desire for pleasure, that is why you are sad. That is why you don't have this feeling of fulfillment and longing. And so for Freud, the way you are to be happy, your psychosis and your soul and your person, is to say yes to every pleasure and every desire. What an inheritance he has left for us in America. This is a significant shift. This is fundamentally different understanding of what a desire is and how we are to live with it. In the past, people were responsible for restraining and controlling their desires, but today it is the right of all people to follow their authentic self in all their desires that they have. This, again, is one of the most powerful lies that the enemy is using today. Our desires are being played like a fiddle from the devil, and we have no idea what is happening. And Paul says, there is another option, and that is the Spirit. And the Spirit and the flesh are in conflict. They are at war. They are at battle. They are opposed of each other. And this is the fight that you and I fight every day. This is the language why you are so exhausted at the end of your day. Because if you follow Jesus, your disordered desires just don't magically Harry Potter wand disappear when you accept Jesus. They are still in you. You still have your upbringing and your childhood and your desire, all these things. And yet every day you're seeking to follow the Spirit and to obey him. And yet you have the desires of your flesh and they're waging war. And some of you don't even know you're fighting a war. And you're like, man, I'm getting wounded and I don't know where. I don't know why. I am exhausted. This is why you are in the middle of a battle between the flesh and the Spirit. And what are the consequences? What are the actions of the flesh? He continues in verse 19. The acts of the flesh are obvious. Okay, Paul, in case they're not obvious, let us know. He's very kind in that way. Sexual immorality, impurity, and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. This does not sound like the promises that our God has made to his people. This doesn't sound like the life that God wants us to live. This doesn't sound like a motivator for his son to hang upon the cross, to suffer and die so that we could have the freedom to maybe have this as one of our options. What is the better option? Let's go to our kids' ministry favorite, verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit, again, this is not in my notes, this is a pet peeve. This is like right behind Revelations. It's Revelation. This is like right underneath it. It's not fruits of the Spirit, plural. This is singular fruit of the Spirit. That's just, I had to say it. But the fruit, singular, of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. Those who belong to Jesus Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. So the second metaphor, the first was battle. The second metaphor I want to use is fruit. And really, I just want to give you some pastoral reflections instead of teaching from the fruit of the Spirit. We've heard so many sermons on the fruit of the Spirit, so I'm going to change it up. Here's a pastoral reflection on the fruit of the Spirit. First thing about fruit. Fruit is the result of a process. Like you have a seed, and it just doesn't magically produce fruit. To make that seed produce fruit, you have to go through a process. And often that process involves external factors outside of this seed with potential for you to bring it about. You have to find good soil. You have to till it up. You have to plant it. You have to be the one that waters it. You have to make sure vermin and squirrels and whatever and owls don't come and attack it. Like, you have responsibility, external factors for you to do things to bring about the potential in the seed. And so here's just what I want you to know. You have responsibility. There are things for you to do to bring about the potential of what God has in you. And so here's a question to reflect on. What are you doing to tend to your life and relationships with Jesus and others? What are the ways that you can till the soil, water the ground, protect from things getting at the seed to bring about the fruit that is possible in your life? The second thing about fruit is the season dictates the action. In the winter you prune, in the spring you plant, in the fall you harvest, and in the summer you definitely stay inside where the AC struggles to keep up as you watch everything die. Okay, no, but we live in Texas, that's just how it is. But the season determines what you do to the plant. It would be ridiculous and detrimental if you pruned in the wrong season. The beauty of the fruit's potential would never be seen if you planted in the wrong season. So here's a question. What season do you find yourself in? Instead of fighting the season that you find yourself in, what would it look like to embrace where you are and to do what the season calls so that you may take the next season on and produce fruit? Lastly, when it comes to fruit, my encouragement is just to grow where you're planted. It would do no good for a watermelon to wish it grew like an apple tree. Kids would be in trouble playing underneath a watermelon tree, just boom, right? Like, and yet often I look at the church and we look at other fruits and we wish we were them. And we're not satisfied with who we are and where God has planted us. And we wish that we were something and someone else. Where does God have you? Because he has placed you in the season and he has planted you exactly where he wants you to be. Not your friend, not your coworker, not your pastor, but where are you right now? And how can you embrace being content even though you're not like other people? Dallas Willard brilliantly said, God has yet to bless anyone except where they actually are. How beautiful is that? Last metaphor, walk. Verse 25. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of your flesh. Walking is the holy pace that we live our lives. Jesus lived at a holy pace. Jesus walked everywhere he went. While Jesus was what? Walking by the Sea of Galilee, he called the disciples. Walking is a pace that we need to reclaim in our lives. We are running, we are sprinting, and we are exhausted. May Jesus call you to a different pace of life. That if you're gonna fight a battle, and if you're gonna produce fruit, listen, it's gonna require for you to slow down. It's not run by the Spirit. It is walk by the Spirit. in Genesis 3, when they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. We have a great legacy of walking. It was the people of God walking in the desert as they made their way to the promised land. And as they walked in the promised land for 40 years to the promised land, what led them? A pillar of cloud and a fire by night. And how beautiful is this, that we walk by the Spirit. The presence of God and a pillar of cloud and fire led the people of God as they walked in the desert. And by God's grace, today in 2023, we walk by the very presence of the Spirit of God inside of us wherever we go. Listen, if you want to produce fruit, if you want to reimagine freedom and use your freedom to serve and love others instead of indulging your flesh and saying yes to all your desires, listen, you have to slow down. You have to slow down. Some of you, quite frankly, are too busy to follow Jesus. If to follow Jesus is to literally follow behind him, and wherever he goes, you follow him and you're right behind him, some of you would be bumping up against Jesus, pushing him. Jesus, can you go a little faster? We got some things to do. And yet Jesus, who is the most important person with the most important mission, who had any excuse to go faster than he should, chose to walk everywhere he went. I'm going to call the band back up, and we're going to close with some prayer. Listen, this is the air that we breathe in, that freedom and the desires of your flesh is a right as an American for you to say yes to and indulge the flesh. But there is a different way that we can use our freedom to serve and love others. That in the battle between the flesh and the Spirit, there is a possibility of victory. And not just a possibility of victory, the victory has already been won in Jesus. And all you have to do is to accept that victory and by the power of the Spirit, walk in step with the Spirit so that you can produce fruit that is beautiful and not only nourishing for you, but for other people. And here's one of the last things I just want to leave you with. I'm not telling you to try harder. That's not the message of this day. It's like, oh, I have all these desires. I'm struggling. I don't know what to do. Adam's just saying that I need to try harder and to serve others. I need to say no to things and slow down so I can serve others and love others. This is not a message of try harder. This is a message that Jesus has accomplished for you, and he's inviting you to step into freedom that is unlike any other. How do we crucify the desires of the flesh? By the power of the Spirit, not the power of you. And that Spirit is available for you this morning. And so we're going to go into a time of singing and worshiping, but we're also going to create space for the Spirit that gives freedom, to move in this room. And so if you want to come up for prayer, we'll be up front for prayer. If you want to come to the back of the room for prayer, we would love to pray with you. Here is my motivation. Here is the words that I want to frame these next few minutes as we end. In 2 Corinthians, Paul says this, "Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we who with unveiled faces all reflect the Lord's glory are being transformed into his likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord who is the Spirit." I think many of us are settling. We're settling for our desires when what is on the table? The Lord offers ever-increasing glory. The church is hungry. The Spirit is using people hungry and thirsty for righteousness. And would we be a people who don't settle for little desires, but we settle for ever-increasing glory? That is what the Lord offers. Let us receive ever-increasing glory. So come up front. If you're in the battle like, man, I am in the trenches. The desires of my flesh are overwhelming me. I am losing. I am just fighting for my life and it is not going well, come forward and we'll pray for the Spirit that gives freedom to come into your life. Maybe you identify with the fruit and it's like, man, I'm not producing much. I'm not content with where I am. I'm just looking at other people's fruit, wishing I could have that. Would you come forward and we're gonna pray that Lord would reap a harvest over your life, that you'd be satisfied where you are and the Spirit would use you. So come, come Holy Spirit.
Song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show.
None beside.
Lord, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And so we claim it because you have offered it to us. Lord, help us to be people that bear fruit in love and service to others. We pray these things in your name. Amen. If y'all could stand up, thank y'all so much for coming to join us in worship this morning. We hope that you were blessed and that the Lord ministered to you in some way. If there's anything that we can do for you or to pray with you or to help in any way, please come talk to us. We'd love to partner with you in any way that we can. As we go, the Spirit of the Lord brings freedom. Would that not just be an idea in your head, but would that be the reality in your heart? And that the desires of your flesh would dissipate and desires of the Spirit would bring victory in your life. And that the fruit that you produce would nourish all those around you as you love and serve them. As we go, let's walk together and make a difference.
Holy, there is no one.